Namaste to all of you. Very warm welcome to this evening's call. Friends, this week, Pragya Bharati, we thought we'd focus on our Akhand Bharat, issues pertaining to the extended Bharat. As part of it, we have had somebody from Balochistan who spoke to us a few days back. And day before yesterday, we had Zafar Sahito Ji from Sindh who spoke. And today we have Omendra Ji who's going to talk about the plight of Pakistani Hindus pretty soon. But before that, it is my customary duty to introduce Pragya Bharati to those of you who are probably coming for the first time on the call. Friends, Pragya Bharati is an intellectual forum. This has been working among intellectuals for the past more than 28 years. This was founded by five intellectuals, prominent among them, as you are all aware, our chairman, Dr. Hanuman Chaudhary Ji. He is a Padma Shri awardee, and he has been a former chairman of VSNL and also IT advisor to the government of Bangladesh. And then, Ram Madhav Ji, who is currently the National General Secretary of Bharatiya Janata Party. B.S. Sharma Ji, who is a pharmaceutical professional. And we had two more gentlemen who are no more with us, Vakati Pandaranga Rao Ji and Harihara Sharma Ji. These five people started Pragya Bharati almost 28 years back with a view that a Bharatiya perspective, a nationalistic perspective, is brought about in the intellectual field. Otherwise, the intellectualism was getting hijacked by forces that are inimical to Bharat. So that is the background in which they started. We conduct a lot of conferences, seminars, workshops as part of our activities. But more importantly, we ensure that the Bharatiya perspective in every aspect of intellectualism is brought forth and then given a place of importance. We have invested in many intellectuals who are otherwise undecided, or who are even people who are on the left side of the debates. We brought them onto the right side of the debate. We also run a magazine by name Bharatiya Pragya. This is an English monthly magazine. So kindly do subscribe to it. This is not available on newsstand. This is only available on subscription. So I request all of you to kindly subscribe to this. Those of you who are not already subscribed to it. Friends, we also request you to kindly like, share, and subscribe to our social media assets, our Twitter handle Pragya Bharati, our Facebook handle Pragya Bharati, as well as our YouTube channel, Pragya Bharati. All these webinars that we have been doing in the past 3 months are getting uploaded into our YouTube channel. So kindly subscribe to it and share it among your friends, that this rich content is available to everyone across. Also, Pragya Bharati, we award an annual award, what we call as Pragya Puraskar. This is given to eminent citizens who have contributed significantly for the cause of the glory of Bharat. The last recipient was Dr. Satish Reddy. He is currently the scientific advisor to the Prime Minister of India. It included the chairman of Veda Bharati, Sri R.V.S. Zawadanlu Ji, and also we had others like Francois Gauthier and so many others. Friends, Pragya Bharati has been relentlessly working in this particular field after the COVID or this Chinese Wuhan coronavirus hit us. In fact, till the lockdown period was over, till the last day of the lockdown period, before the unlockdown period started, we had a daily webinar on Zoom that we were conducting. And we had some very wonderful speakers, stalwarts, activists and intellectuals who came on our call and enriched our period in this lockdown time. Post the unlockdown period, we have staggered it a bit. We are doing it in English 3 times a week, and in Telugu, we are doing 4 times a week. Our Karimnagar unit has been doing the Telugu webinars on Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and Sunday. We are doing our English webinars on Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturdays. So kindly make note of it and make it a point that you fix your calendar to be part of our program. Friends, today we have amongst us Sri Ominder Ji. Ominder Ji and Jay Ahuja Ji, these two are from Jaipur. They are running an organization called Nimit Tekam. Ominder Ji is a doctor by profession, and he is also a writer, singer, and an activist. And Jay Ahuja Ji has his own business, very successful business in Jaipur. So both of them are part of this group. They founded this group called Nimit Tekam. They have been working among the Pakistani Hindus who come on this side of the border with literally nothing on them. It's so difficult for them to get an Indian visa. They're all people who come legally. They're not the people who cross over the border illegally. They come legally. They get the visa, come here, surrender the passport to the local authorities and say, we want asylum in India. We are not going back. Because the families which survived for 7 decades in Pakistan are struggling to survive today. Every day we are hearing cases of our Hindu girls being kidnapped, converted and married off to much, much older people, a second, third wife. And then in no time, these girls are seen in flesh trade. This is a sad reality of Pakistan. And Ominder Ji, Jay Ahuja Ji and their Nimit Tekam team has been working among those people who have come here. Even those that come here, they have to struggle for almost 11 years, they don't get citizenship. And after 11 years, once they apply, even then the bureaucracy was so painful. It had to go to Delhi, get approvals, 10,000 rupees. These people hardly have money to survive. And in scorching deserts of Rajasthan, these people are barely able to make it. For them, between Pakistan and India, there's hardly any difference. Except that here, people are probably not forcing them to convert. Among such people, Nimit Tekam has been working and giving some relief and succor to these people, standing up for their rights and ensuring that they don't fall back prey to this barbaric conversion machinery that has been unleashed by this artificial demagogue Pakistan. Friends, there are thousands and thousands of people still in Pakistan who are desperate to come on this side of the border. Those that are unable to make it are even now converting. So this is a area of very significant cause of concern for all of us. Not just Pakistan. Today, China is occupying large tracts of Sindh and Balochistan. And so the culture of our great ancient Bharat in those lands is as good as dying, in spite of the relentless fight by these people for the past 7 decades. It's a very emotional topic for all of us. And we value and respect Ominder Ji and his team for the yeoman service they are doing in protecting these people and ensuring that something still flickers and survives. It is our pleasure to have him today, Ominder Ji. I think as you had asked for, before you start your talk, you wanted us to play the video. Shall we do it?
Yeah, just a brief introduction
please,
to this go video.
Ahead. Go ahead, please.
This is something, it's a few lines I had written about 5 years ago. And as I'm father of a daughter, this was something very, very close to my heart. Hence, I never talked about it to anybody. I kept it close to my heart. Only my friends knew about it. But when the CAA opposition, this very, very roguish, very illogical and very cruel, if I may say so, opposition to the CAA happened. As I had some prerana by Mother Saraswati, by Ma Saraswati, and she asked me to compose this, to make a video on this and to sing this and record this. This video is the cry of a Pakistani Hindu father whose daughter is molested in front of his eyes every single day. And as men of honor, we know what, how many deaths does a man die if his daughter is humiliated in front of his eyes. So I've tried to, no amount of writing can express the pain of that father, but I have tried to pen it in few lines. They should shake the consciousness of the slumberous Hindu society to this genocide happening right in front of our eyes. Thank you.
Sure. Dheeraj, can you just play the video, please? Dheeraj, volume is to be taken care. Volume is not coming. Sound is not coming.
Avru, हम भी पाकिस्तानी हैं. इधर हमारा हकूक, हमारा इज्जत, आवरू का पूरे पाकिस्तान को मिलकर साथ देना चाहिए.
पानी पीना पड़ता है. क्यों? हमारा हक नहीं है वहां पे. हम किस लिए काम कर रहे हैं? इसलिए हमको कहा जाता है काम करने. क्यों सर 2 रुपये से हमको देखना चाहते हैं वहां लोग? किस वजह से देखना चाहते हैं? क्योंकि हम हिंदू हैं.
जो जन्नत की ख्वाहिश दरिंदों ने पाली तो क्यों उसकी कीमत भरे मेरी लाली.
मेरी बेटी मैक के सोनी कराची से अगवा हुई है. यहाँ कराची से डिफेंस के इलाके से.
ख्वाहिश दरिंदों ने पाली तो क्यों उसकी कीमत भरे मेरी लाली. क्या था उसमें दोष, क्या उसका कसूर? क्यों लेकर गए हो उसे घर से दूर? इस बेबसी के भार तले क्या जिंदा दफन हो जाऊं? तेरा आंचल जहां आबाद रहे वो धरती कहां से लाऊं? वो धरती कहां से लाऊं?
वाली। अगर काफिरों से ताल्लुक जरूरी भी है ना तो बस इतना ही है जैसे लैटरीन के अंदर जाना मजबूरी है।
वहशत की वेदी पे रंजिश है पाली, कहां के तवराते कहां की दिवाली। वहशत की वेदी पे रंजिश है पाली, मौत है छुटकारा यहां, हर जुल्म हुआ है गवारा यहां। जुल्मों पे खड़े इस आलम के उस पार कैसे जाऊं, सदगुरुओं का अवतारों का। तूने तो हमको वचन दिया था धर्म और सत्य निभाने का, आ देख लुटे बैठे हैं हम हर
जस्ट बिकॉज ऑफ रिलीजियन उनको वहाँ से खदेड़ा जाता है, उनका जीना दुष्कर किया जाता है। जो पॉपुलेशन विभाजन के समय 35% थी, जो पॉपुलेशन आज 7% हो गई, उनके लिए तो जगह बची नहीं है। तो वो अगर हिंदुस्तान में आते हैं जो भारत माँ की जय बोलते हैं।
मान्यवर, हमने कहा था पड़ोसी देशों के प्रताड़ित धार्मिक अल्पसंख्यकों के संरक्षण के लिए सिटीजनशिप अमेंडमेंट बिल, जिसको सीएबी के पॉपुलर नाम से जाना जाता है, हम इसको लागू करने के लिए प्रतिबद्ध है।
कर शंखनाद इस वेदना के पार निकल जाऊं, अब हाथ बढ़ा इस दावानल से मैं भी तो मुक्ति पाऊं, मैं भी तो मुक्ति पाऊं। प्राणों का बंधन हृदय का तू स्पंदन, सांसों की वीणा
I don't think you would find any Hindu or Indian who can't have tears in his eyes. I think we all betrayed them. We as Bharat, I think we have betrayed our own brothers and sisters, our children across the border.
Yes, we have Girdhar bhai, and that's why my heart goes out to Shri Narendra Modi when he put this in the election manifesto in the 2014 the general elections, where he said that India is the natural home for Hindus of Pakistan and Bangladesh, and anywhere where the Hindus are persecuted. No Hindu leader ever had the courage to say this publicly. And what we Hindu intellectuals should have lapped up is this opportunity given to us by the CAA to shame this state of Pakistan, which was killing its young daughters. I mean, I don't understand this. How can somebody do this to any community, no matter amount of the hatred that is fed to them? I have been living with Pakistani Hindus for the past 10 years. I can't conceive of damaging any child, whether she be Muslim or Christian. I don't care. A child is a child of God. What kind of people do these things to a child? And on a cosmic scale, jisko hum kehte hain na, mahalay ki scale par, we are all guilty. As long as this happens and we inhabit this globe and we are incapable or unwilling to stop it, then COVID is hardly a price to pay. We deserve bigger punishments. So this is it. I'll try to sum up the whole issue in the next 20 minutes. Then I'll give the stage to Jay, who will talk about the technical aspects of this whole issue, because he's the man on ground. I do the philosophizing and the fund collection for Nimittekam. Nimittekam came about very interestingly when I and Jay met about 8 years ago at a friend's place. He had his own fire, I had my own fire, and we were working with Pakistani Hindus independently in very, very limited capacity. Jay joined hands with me, he collaborated with me, he educated me to a large extent on this issue. And in 2014, everything changed for us, because when a mainstream political party picks up the issue, then it becomes very easy for us to work on this issue. Because before that, as long as the Congress was in power, we were working with Pakistani citizens. It doesn't matter if they were Hindus or Sardars or Christians. The fact that they possessed a Pakistani passport was enough to put me and Jay behind bars under an NSA. Thanks to this one man, Narendra Modi, this change in 2014, we started openly working for them. In 2016, Nimittekam came about. Nimittekam is a word taken from Sri Bhagavad Gita, when Sri Krishna says that you be only the instrument of my work on this prithvi. So tomorrow, if Nimittekam was to become big, nobody has to be under any illusion that we are the doers. We are still only the instruments. That is why I named it thus, Nimittekam. I want to thank you, Girdhaji, for pronouncing it correctly. Most of the Hindus don't get it correctly. Most of them end up saying Nimiketam and Nimittem, and you know, they can't even pronounce it. Unfortunate that Sanskrit has been eradicated from our lingo.
Thankfully, so, in South India, you know, the pronunciations are decently saved, survived.
They are preserved, yeah. So
because we were not under the Islamic rule for long periods of time.
So So it's very, very, it gives a warm feeling in the heart. So Nimittekam came about in 2016, and here's where Jay's role comes. He gave his own land worth 50 lakh rupees. And today, Nimittekam office stands on the land donated by Jay Ahuja. So he walked the talk. It's not that we are only collecting funds from global Hindus. Jay did his part, and he actually transferred the property to Nimittekam, and today Nimittekam office stands on that. So I'll take all my friends to the journey of Pakistani Hindus in the next 15 minutes under four headings. The first is the genesis of the problem. the genesis of the problem stays comes in with the absolute debauchery committed by Gandhi and Nehru. And the only person who stood against this debauchery was a person I place as valuable and as high as Shri Krishna himself, and that was Baba Sahib Ambedkar. He was one man who said that if you're partitioning the country on the basis of religion, let there be a total exchange of populations. But Baba Sahab was sidelined mercilessly. He became so bitter that he had to symbolically even convert to Buddhism because he was completely sidelined. He predicted this fate falling upon Hindus of Pakistan and Bangladesh. That time, you can read all his articles. It is all in print. So the genesis lies in the lies perpetrated by Congress and absolute abandonment of these Hindus at the mercy of jihadis. The next thing is that what is the dimension of this problem? The dimension of this problem is that every Hindu staying in Pakistan has to have a dual identity. When he goes out to work, suppose his name is Prakash, then he also has to have a name by the name of Zafar or Salim, with which people refer to him when he's out there in the public. Because if anybody finds out that he's a Hindu, then he will be, first of all, be mocked for being a Hindu. They will look at him as if they're looking at an animal in a zoo, in a cage. And people will come and touch him and, you know, see him go, okay, this is how a Hindu looks like. And of course, he will never get a business opportunity. His money will be taken. His honor will be taken. His daughter will be picked up anytime. So these people live with a concealed identity. It's remarkable that they even continue remaining Hindus after facing so much hardships. Their businesses are constantly under threat. The rich Hindus purchase their safety with their money. Poor Hindus, which is in the rural Sindh, they are bonded laborers of these Vaderas. Vaderas are the landlords. As most of your friends would be knowing that in Pakistan, the Zamindari system never ended. It ended in Bharat, but in Pakistan, even today, there are Zamindars who are huge, thousands of acres of landowners, and they are called as Vaderas. They have a huge political clout. They have a huge amount of money and resources at their disposal. So most of the Hindus, 90% of the Hindus in Pakistan today are bonded laborers of these Vaderas who are sexually, physically, and emotionally violated constantly. Then the genocide. The genocide, I don't know the academic criteria of a genocide, but in May 2019, the European Union Parliament comes up with a report that 1,000 minority girls are picked every year in Pakistan from their homes. They're raped by the entire villages and converted to Islam in the full view of the world. In the 21st century, 24/7 television, this is going on right under our noses. And that comes about to an average of 3 girls per day. And since we are not actually working with Christians, we have only started working now with Pakistani Christians, but we have been actively working with Pakistani Hindus and Pakistani Sardars. So this is like 2 to 3 Hindu girls being picked every single day. Let that sink into our consciousness. Let that figure sink into us. That while we are merrymaking, while we are watching Bollywood and cricket, while we are discussing mundanities, while we are doing theme parties, while we are vacationing, 3 Hindu girls are being picked every single day from their homes. That is the scale of genocide that Hindus of Pakistan are facing today. The things have really worsened in the past 6 months because of COVID crisis and the hostilities between India and Pakistan. The train coming from Karachi to Jodhpur has stopped now. And for the last 6 months, not even one Hindu we have managed to take out from
I think he's lost the connection, it looks like. Yeah, he's back.
The third part of my talk is that we save them and we save ourselves. Please pay attention to this. What is the need to save Pakistani Hindus? We may say we have a lot of, even my wife used to say this a couple of years ago, that we have enough Hindus here, the population is here, and they are poor and they are marginalized. Why don't you serve them? Why? What is so special about Pakistani Hindus? Mm. So I'll try to explain this to you in the next 3-4 minutes. What is special about Pakistani Hindus is that they are a very, very courageous people whom we have relegated to the dustbins of history. Hindus have a very poor sense of history, at least for the last 5 or 6 decades. If we want to look back upon our history with pride and we want to change, you know, make amends to what mistakes our other leaders have done, it is these Hindus who give us that chance to go back, to reach out to them and pick them up. It's like they are in a time warp, you know, in like movies. They are static in a time zone. They have not studied. They have no money. They are living there like zombies. And suddenly a Hindu group comes and picks them up, takes them up to Karachi, puts them in a train, takes care of their visa thing, and they end up with us. And they don't believe that they are in a new land. It is like Dvijak, second Janma. They have taken a second Janma. So we owe it to them. Secondly, a lot of right-wing intellectuals keep worrying about the demographics, the falling demographics of Hindus. And we keep coming up with some idiotic solution that Hindus should start having 4 children. At least I can tell you in my family that even 10 years ago, if I were to ask my wife to have a child, she would slap me out of her bedroom and say, okay, go and get lost. So that's these kind of stupid suggestions keep coming. If we want to halt the demographic inversion, even for 5 or 10 years' time, there are 7 million Hindus in Pakistan. Some say even 10 million, but I'm being conservative here. And that's what Giridharji, please correct this, not a few thousand, 7 million, 70 lakh Hindu Pakistan mein rehte hain. Imagine if we are able to take them out of Pakistan. 1.5 crore Hindus live in Bangladesh. We get a respite of minimum 5 to 10 years. The demographic inversion can be halted. All of these Hindus, at least Pakistani Hindus, I can tell you, have none of them have less than 6 children. So these guys are like, you know, they are our fertility machines. And 2 other aspects why we need to save them. To destroy the meme bheem narrative being perpetrated in your land, especially by the great people of Bhagyanagar. Under the great leadership of this man. So this meme bheem combination can be destroyed if we take up the Pakistani Hindu issue aggressively to the Hindu population. 90% of the Hindus staying in Pakistan today and trying to come out of Pakistan are our Dalit Sahodaras. I don't use the word Dalit because Dalit by word implies that somebody is downtrodden. I don't see these Hindus as downtrodden. They are my Sahodaras. They are my rakt brothers. We are born of the same mother. Imagine the amount of goodwill we generate and amount of destruction of the narrative of meme bheem happens when we showcase these Dalits, Sahodaras to the rest of the world that this is what jihadis are doing to our Dalit Sahodaras. Megwals, Bheels, Kolis, Balais, Old Rajputs, Bagdis, they are all scheduled castes and scheduled tribes of our religion who are being persecuted by the jihadis. And the last thing, from being a few lakhs to being reduced to few thousands now, are our Sardar brothers. Last August 2019, the daughter of the main Granthi of Nankana Sahib was picked in broad daylight. And that video is shown in the song that I have displayed. And then in 3rd January 2020, the Nankana Sahib Gurudwara was attacked by a crowd of 2,000 jihadis and said that we are going to rename Nankana Sahib as Ghulam-e-Mustafa Nagar. So the whole narrative of Khalistan can be put into the gutter by showing the world that this is what jihadis are doing to Sikh population of Pakistan you expect them to be your brothers and your saviors in coming years, good luck to you. But this is the truth. We have about 300 Sikh Sahodaras living in Faridabad who came to Bharat from Sindh in 2008. Till date, they haven't got citizens. We took care of them during the COVID crisis. You provided them with rations. We have all the videos I can share with the friends here if they want to. And we are taking care of the citizenship. And as soon as CAA gets activated, these 300 Sardars will get citizenship. So there are about 30,000 Sardars, mainly living in KPK province of Pakistan, who need to be extricated and showcased to the world. Showcased to our lost Sardar brothers who might have some sympathy for Khalistan. That this is what this cabal of industrial military complex of Pakistan is doing to Sardars. There is no scope of your friendship with them. The next aspect, I have two more issues to tackle and then I'll finish up my talk. The next 5 minutes will be a little bit academic. I expect everybody's attention to me and I want this to be imbibed into the consciousness, into the pragya of every Pragya Bharati member who's listening to this. Why did this happen? You know, as an intellectual, as a surgeon, I always go for the cause. You know, we try to find out why do cancers happen? Why does sinusitis happen? Why do diseases happen? We go for the cause, right? So why did Pakistani Hindu genocide happen right under our noses? I have an acronym for this. Random, unceasing, low-level, scattered violence. The acronym is RULLS. Akasmat, you know, sudden. Anvarat, unceasing. Laghu Shreni ki, low-level. Chitri hui hinsa, scattered. I'll explain every word. Random. Every crime, every disease has a pattern, but for the jihadi violence. There is no pattern. No CIA, no KGB, no intelligence agency, no Mossad can predict when a jihadi attack is going to happen. When a daughter of a Hindu or a Sardar will be picked up in Pakistan, that cannot be predicted. It is random. There is no pattern, no scientific pattern to this disease. Unceasing. It has been going on for the last 1400 years. It started with Muhammad bin Qasim attacking Raja Dahir. And the attacks have not stopped. They will not stop till Ghazwa-e-Hind is achieved. That is something Hindus need to understand. Low level, the most dangerous aspect of this acronym. Keep the level of violence at a level so that kafirs are covering in a corner. Never raise the level of a violence to a level where kafirs get united and respond. Kafir ki zindagi mein itni hinsa karte raho ki wo dara rahe. Lekin itni hinsa bhi mat karo ki kafir ikhatta hoke hame jawab dene par aa jaye. Do I need to elaborate on this or has everybody understood? Giridharji?
Yeah, go ahead.
Do I need to elaborate? When was the low level violence pattern broken? It was broken in Godhra. That's all that I'll say. So the last aspect of this is scattered. It will happen in San Bernardino. It will happen in Barcelona, it will happen in New Delhi, it will happen in Nigeria. There is no geographic locale where this violence is not going to hit. Now look at it in the perspective of Pakistani Hindus. Suppose there is a terrorist attack in Rajasthan, in Jaipur. There was one in 2008 and about 70 odd people were killed. The whole world noticed. Mumbai happened, the whole world noticed. The whole world went after it. Do we even know that after 2014, after Narendra Modi ji's taking oath as the Prime Minister, more than 100 Hindus have been killed in Bharat in political violence, 22 being in Karnataka alone, Do we even know this? Why don't we know this? Because it's not a fantastic violence. It happens to a B grade or a C grade Hindu leader. The news comes in the lower corner of the paper. We see, okay, somebody was killed. We never read who killed whom. We never follow up. We don't even know the names of the people who killed Kamlesh Tiwari. That is the magic of random, unceasing, low-level, scattered violence. Close to 6,000 Hindus have been migrating out of Pakistan every year. Every single year. In 1971 war, 1 lakh Hindus migrated in one single day. Why don't we know about it? Because the world doesn't pay attention to small incidents. The world pays attention to fantastic events. So the philosophy of bleeding India by 1,000 cuts actually applies to Hindu dharma that destroy Hinduism by 1,000 cuts. And that is why the Hindu consciousness was numbed from feeling the pain of these Pakistani Hindus. I'll come to the last part of my talk as to what we have achieved at Nimittekam and what are our future plans. Although part of it will be covered by what Jay will talk. Nimittekam has managed to take out 10,000 Hindus out of Pakistan in the past 6 years. We have got a number of citizenship, exact number of citizens, only Jay will be able to tell you. We, for the past 6 months now, since we know that Hindus are not being extricated out of Pakistan because of the hostilities between India and Pakistan, we are now trying to take the Hindus out of Pakistan to Canada, to Australia, to US, to European Union. But to that end, we'll have to document every atrocity that is happening. And we have a dedicated team of journalists now working with Nimittekam to document each and every kidnapping and rape and murder happening in Pakistan so that we can take the document to the international community and seek asylum for these unfortunate victims of time. So these are the connotations and the various aspects of this issue I've tried to cover in the past 20-25 minutes. I now request my brother and Karma Yodha Jay Ahuja to take over from me and explain the legal aspects of Citizenship Amendment Act and the legalities of the situation and what kind of horrors these people face in Pakistan and Bharat and our future plans. Over to Jay. Thank you so much.
Dhanyavad, Dr. Ratnu. Ji. कहाँ से शुरू करूँ मतलब ये इट्स अ लॉन्ग जर्नी सिंस लॉन्ग टाइम वी आर लिविंग इन दिस
ब्रीफली यू कैन टेल अस अबाउट योर इंटरेक्शन विद निमित्तेकम द इशू ऑफ पाकिस्तानी हिंदूज
जी
एंड इंटरेक्शन विद द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया हाउ गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया रिस्पोंडेड टू योर कॉल्स एंड व्हाट वाज द जर्नी ऑफ दिस
राइट देयर आर टू डिफरेंट एराज ऑफ आवर वर्किंग वन इज टेक आउट हिंदूज फ्रॉम पाकिस्तान दैट इज अ पार्ट हाउ टू गेट वीजा फ्रॉम इंडियन एम्बेसी इस्लामाबाद So that's a very critical issue. That's a very, you know, complex issue because our government, Indian government, has put 9 countries in the list of pre-intimated country. And all 9 countries are basically Muslim countries. So Pakistan is on number 1. So not a single Pakistani, either Hindu, Muslim, or from any other faith, they can come to India directly and they can get visa directly. So they need a sponsor from India. They need a Indian citizen as a sponsor to have visa and the documentation of sponsorship is very complex. That should be attested by a senior government official with their IDs also. So whenever we talk to government people, though they, you know, they got convinced with us, okay, it is a human cause, we are ready to help you. And they started signing the sponsorship document. We sent the documents to Pakistan, to the relatives and friends of people who are in India and they have some relative or friends in Pakistan and they want to migrate all Hindus or Sikh families. So they go to Pakistani, they go to Islamabad in Indian High Commissioner Pakistan. They apply their visa and then the whole application comes to Bharat with digital as a digital document and मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ एक्सटर्नल अफेयर्स के सेक्रेटरी दे रिसीव द डॉक्यूमेंट एंड दे सेंड इट टू होम मिनिस्ट्री एंड द होम सेक्रेटरी सेंड इट टू अंडर सेक्रेटरी अंडर सेक्रेटरी इज यूजुअली सेंड इट टू द नेम IB chief send it to local IB office and they assign an inspector to verify the sponsor and they verify basically two things. One, sponsor should not be anti-national and sponsor should not be anti-social. So if they feel that the sponsor is a good person and we can, send the positive report to the Pakistan Indian High Commissioner, they send it back. So it takes almost 4 to 5 months. Meanwhile, sometimes IB people or CID people usually, talk to the person, the government official, ke, sir, aapne ye signature kiye hai kya? Aur aapko pata hai kya, aapke guarantee pe, aapke official ID pe, Pakistan se koi aadmi ko, aapke known log yahan bula rahe hai, to aap ek government officer ho, aapko pata hai ye baat. So, generally, next time it is very critical to have one more signature on one more document, sponsorship document by that person, government official. So this is a bottleneck for us. Second, the process of visa is very complex, 4 to 5 months. Third, 2000 visas are bilaterally decided by both the countries. So in 2000 visas, there are a lot of Muslims are applying to come Bharat for some business work or for to meet relatives or for Jiarat or any other thing. They are in the queue. Some Hindus or Sikhs are coming for pilgrim, like go to Harminder Sahib, Amritsar, or want to go to Haridwar, Gangaji, to Asti Visarjan of their relatives. They are also in the queue. And people who have proper sponsorship document, they want to come to Bharat for permanent settlement. They are also in the queue. So not more than 500 visas we are getting since last some years per month. So this is a bottleneck. So that's why our Hindu brothers are there. They are captain jihadis and they want to come out, but they don't have way out to come out. So this is the story, how we are working on visa issue. And when they come to Bharat, we will take them to CID office for their registration. And we will apply within 30 days for their asylum and resident visa, which is called long-term visa. And it takes almost 1 year to be done. So this is again a bottleneck. So till the time they cannot move out from their sponsor's place. So they are basically political hostages till the time they are getting that particular document called.
Yeah, please tell us about the difference it has made in between 2014 and before 2014 and after 2014 and what the kind of notifications that Rajnath Singh ji did with Jaisalmer. Please tell me that.
Let me explain everything. So this is a normal procedure. So before 2016, since last 70 years, they were not allowed to go outside of a municipal or a panchayat area where they got their base visa station. Like they cannot decide where they are going to stay. This is mandatory where their sponsor is living, the same place they have to choose as their visa base station. So earlier they were not allowed to move out from the municipal area, but in 2016, 16th August 2016, Rajnath Singh ji sir has given a detailed notification about their things. One, they were allowed to move all the state because earlier they were not allowed to go outside of a town. Now they are allowed to, like in Rajasthan, now they can roam around in the Rajasthan without any additional visa or permission. But they are restricted to go to border areas across the country due to security issue. Number two, first time in the history after partition, they are allowed to have a bank account, a normal saving bank account. They were not allowed to have a bank account. Now they are allowed to have a driving license. Since last 70 years, they were not allowed to having a driving license. They can purchase, buy a property, residential property, up to 1500 square feet for their own use, for self-occupation. So it was not allowed. Earlier, officially, there were no written documents that they can do jobs or business. So all things were they were doing, that was, legally it was not correct, but they were helpless. Kaam to kuch karna hi padega jinda rehne ke liye. Now they are officially allowed to do jobs and they are officially allowed to do businesses. and for their business and official jobs, they are allowed to have two more outstate stations also to go and come back and commute in the transit area. So this is a wonderful relief done by Government of India in 2016. And after that, Rajnath Singh ji, that sir, please do something. Then Rajnath Singh ji introduced CAA in 2016 also. And it was passed in Lok Sabha, but due to some issue numbers, it was not presented in Rajya Sabha. Then again, Rajnath Singh ji do one more wonderful thing. We requested Rajnath Singh ji that a layman from Pakistan, persecuted minority from Pakistan, they don't have courage to go and meet with the Home Secretary of India, because it's a big deal. And earlier, Home Secretary of India was the only entitled person to issue citizenship to eligible cases. So we requested Rajnath Singh ji, and on our request, Rajnath Singh ji has done a survey in his tenure. And 16 districts marked by Government of India, where more than 5,000 Hindus from Pakistan or Sikhs from Pakistan are living. And they given the permission to 16 Jila collectors, district collectors directly to grant citizenship on the basis of 1955 Citizenship Act. And first citizenship we got in Jaipur on 15th May 2017. And it was like a ice break for after a long time, and the happiness.
That was a game changer, I think.
The game changer.
Giving permission to district collectors to grant citizenship was
a game changer, and the whole country, people started calling us how you got citizenship for these people. So I traveled to Bhopal, I traveled to other districts, I went to Chhattisgarh, I went to Haryana, I went to a lot of places, Mumbai, I went to
Pune. I have a question. Was this the order not passed by Shri Atal Bihari ji during his tenure also?
Yeah, actually it was, all groundwork done by Shri Advani ji on the demand of people, because in 1994, there was an Assam Accord applied by Narsingh Rao ji, and it was initiated by Shri Rajiv Gandhi in 1985. And due to Assam Accord, the power of citizenship granting was, centralized to Government of India's Home Secretary. So that was a bottleneck created, and that is how people... the backlog was there, and because of that backlog, people were not able to get citizenship because their respective collectors had no right to grant citizenship. So at that time, Advani ji did a survey, and Advani ji did an arrangement to give power to collectors in 9 states. And Advani ji said that Northeast issue is different, and Pakistani Hindus issue is different. So we are going to grant the power to these 9 states like Rajasthan, Haryana, Punjab, Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh and Madhya Pradesh. These are like these areas, Gujarat and all. So before granting this, before signing this document, the government went out in 2004 election, and the same happened with the help of Shri Ashok Gehlot in 2004 December, and Mr. Shivraj Patil signed the same document on the request of Ashok Gehlot ji, and this order issued for 2 years to collectors. 17,000 people got the citizenship in that two years from December 2004 to December 2006, and which people didn't have eligibility, they left out behind, and the window was closed, and the backlog was big, and the particular backlog we are dealing these days with our efforts. So
my question is that between 2006 and 2014, not one Hindu got citizenship.
No, not a single Hindu got citizenship.
I hope everybody is listening.
So one important thing which is we have to look back to 1950. Prime Minister Liaquat Ali Khan and Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru ji, Prime Minister of India, met in Delhi, and they discussed some positive issues. The agenda was that we have fought a lot. Now we are two countries. There was an idea of two nation theory, and it happened finally. with a lot of bloodshed and a lot of issues. Now go ahead with good deeds. And both the prime minister decided two things about their minorities. Number one, both the countries are going to take care of their own minorities and trying to resettle there. They are committed to resettle there in their own country if they want to live there. Number two, if some minority thinks that they have mistaken and at the time of partition, they should move to other part of country, like Muslims from Bharat and Hindus or Sikhs from Christians from Pakistan, but they are still in Pakistan or they are still in India. So in some time, if they want to move to Pakistan, some Muslims or some minorities from Pakistan want to move to Bharat. So both the countries are committed to give them mandatory shelter. That was a legal arrangement on document. And number two, both the countries will grant them citizenship on priority basis. They will not treat them as normal foreigner from any other country. So that was the arrangement. So there was one leader called Shri J.B. Kriplani, Acharya Kriplani, Congress leader from Sindh, and he migrated to Bharat in partition. So then he started following up to Pandit Nehru ki ab us pe kuch kijiye, ab us pe kuch kijiye. Then Pandit Nehru said ki we will definitely do something after 1952 when we will be elected. Now this time we are a working government and we got the keys from Britishers, but after 1952 we will definitely do something. After 1952 again, Shri J.B. Kriplani was after him, do something. Finally, December 1953, there was a parliamentary board to draft a bill, Citizenship Act or Citizenship Bill, came in the picture in 1955, and that's name was Citizenship Act 1955. So there were clear arrangement in Section 51A for minority of Pakistan and Afghanistan. They are eligible to get citizenship in 7 years. That is a written documented thing. And we got all the citizenship in that particular arrangement. And for normal foreigners, there is a section called Section 61. And if you are from any other country or from Pakistan, you are not minority of Pakistan or Afghanistan, then you must be treated as a normal foreigner. And if you live 12 years in Bharat, you can claim a citizenship. And if your papers are right and if government thinks that there is no security threat with your citizenship, they will grant you citizenship. And that is how Adnan Sami also got the citizenship in that particular Section 6.1. So in new citizenship act...
So you initially talked about the Nehru Liaquat Pact. And yeah. Then followed up by 1955 Citizenship Act.
Yeah. One right? more thing. So there was a rider. There was a rider in that particular thing in Section 51A for minority of Pakistan and Afghanistan. Only those people can get the benefit who born in undivided India or the first generation or their mother or father born in undivided India in India. तो जिस भी व्यक्ति का जन्म 1947 से पहले हुआ है या जिसके माता पिता का जन्म 1947 से पहले हुआ है, केवल उन्हीं पाकिस्तानी और अफगानिस्तानी अल्पसंख्यकों को सेक्शन 51A में जल्दी सिटीजनशिप का लाभ मिल सकता है। अब यहां से हमारी बात शुरू होती है जो 10 साल पहले मैंने और माननीय शंकर लालवानी जी हु इज दीज डेज माननीय शंकर जी इज मेंबर ऑफ पार्लियामेंट फ्रॉम इंदौर and he's like our mentor, Shri Arjun Meghwal ji, central minister, he's like our mentor. Shri Gajen Singh ji from Jodhpur, government of India's Jal Shakti Mantri, he's our mentor. So these people were there. So Shankar ji and we decided to take this issue to respective people. ये जब तक आप 1947 का राइडर नहीं हटाएंगे तो जिन बच्चों के लिए माइग्रेशन हो रहा है उन बच्चों को नागरिकता कैसे मिलेगी उन बच्चों को तो 12 साल 12 इयर्स वेट करना पड़ेगा तो ये तो इनजस्टिस है सो दैट इज हाउ वी स्टार्टेड दिस
आहुजा जी कैन आई रिक्वेस्ट यू काइंडली इफ यू कैन स्पीक इन इंग्लिश
राइट
सर लॉट ऑफ पीपल फ्रॉम तमिलनाडु एंड केरला दे
कैन राइट सर सो दैट इज हाउ वी स्टार्टेड आवर कैंपेन दैट द होल माइग्रेशन एंड द होल सिनेरियो ऑफ माइग्रेशन इज रिलेटेड टू द किड्स एंड द फैमिली सो लाइक People like my age, my father was 1.5 years old at the time of partition. If these days my age people come from Pakistan, So only one person from the family can get citizenship early in 7 years clause because he have the document of his father's birth was before partition. But if wife's father born after partition and kids, the obviously if father's age is 40 years, 45 years, then they don't have the proof that their father born before partition. So this was the bottleneck. So we requested to government of India, sir, these kids are suffering with bad things. So they cannot apply for jobs. They cannot apply for good government colleges. They are suffering with their career, their life. So please do something for these kids. So that is how they got convinced and Citizenship Amendment Act came. So they reduced 7 years to 5 years. And they eliminated that particular thing was related to 1947. If someone's parents born before partition, then they can get early citizenship, otherwise not. So that was eliminated. This is a wonderful historical thing done by Shri Narendra Modi, Shri Amit Shah ji. And you, sir, this is for every listener. You guys cannot, you know, feel the feelings of these people, the blessings of these people to Shri Narendra Modi, to Shri Amit Shah ji, to these people. They did a
that cold night thing. when this law was passed in the Rajya Sabha, and we were dancing with tears in our eyes.
We were dancing for days, not nights. We were dancing for days, nights. Some days was like that. We were celebrating like anything. And then one more important thing. So, like Dr. Ratnu already told you, the people are coming with 6 kids, 7 kids, 8 kids, and they are hand to mouth. They have nothing. They were bonded labor there. So, they don't have money to renew their Pakistani passport in Pak Embassy because 6,000 rupees per annum per passport is the cost to renewal of the passport. And 2,000 is the open bribe they ask to every candidate who's going to their embassy for renewal of the passport. So a layman earning 300 rupees, 400 rupees daily wages in daily wages kind of things. If he have 10 people's family, how can he spend 60,000 rupees annually on the renewal of the passport? So we requested to Shri Narendra Modi ji's government, to Amit Shah ji, ki sir, this is, so if you allow them to have citizenship in early times and everything, but if you tell them that you should come up with the regular visa and valid passport, they cannot come up because once their passport got expired, so our agencies usually say them, go to Pak Embassy, get done renewal of your passport, then we will issue the thappa or stamp of your extension of your visa. So that cannot be done, sir, because you have to allow them on their expired documents. They all come with legal documents. They all came India with legal visa, legal passport. But due to their helplessness, due to no money, due to their poorness, they are not, they are not able to do this thing. So on this particular thing, that 31st December 2014, who came in Bharat and their documents are expired, they can go with their expired documents and they can have citizenship under the law called Citizenship Amendment Act. With this particular act, our Indian government has given a big financial setback to Pakistan also.
This huge. Is a huge
more than 300 to... more than 300 crores the fees they should get. One more important document, they charge 10,000 rupees for renunciation certificate, which is called citizenship surrender document. So if someone goes to them, sir, I am surrendering your citizenship, I am surrendering your passport, now give me a certificate called renunciation certificate, they charge 10,000 rupees each for them. So this is in earlier law, this was a mandatory document to get citizenship, but now it is not. So this is something miraculously done by this government for these persecuted people. And this is all our battle was running. Our battle was there to get these reliefs. So now these people are very cheered up, very happy. And every single moment, they are giving a lot of blessings to people who worked for them, to Shri Narendra Modi ji, to Shri Amit Shah ji. And if you want to meet them, if you want to feel their feelings, so they are living gods on the earth. They are living gods on the earth. They had an option to be converted into Islam. They never said yes to read Kalma, and they fought it, and they lived a pathetic life there, and their struggle, and fortunately me and Dr. Ratnu are fighting for them, and this is Shri Bhagwan Krishna's Krapa that we are into this, and this is Mahinglaj Bhavani's Krapa that we are into this. And I am very sure soon we will go to Balochistan as a free Balochistan to go to Shrine Ma Bhagwati Ma Hinglaj Bhavani. And this is all the technical things Dr. Ratnu told me to narrate you, to tell you. So I have some function in at my home also. So if
tell
you
us,
have
tell
some
us
question,
briefly
please.
About your future plans at Nimittekam. Tell us briefly about them.
These days, there is a very complex relationship between Bharat and Pakistan. So we are not able to taking out our brothers and sisters from there. So we are trying to approach our brothers in Australia, Hindu brothers in Australia, Hindu brothers in Canada, Hindu brothers in USA, Hindu brothers in Europe. We are trying to get asylum for these persecuted people in West world also. And again, we are trying to convince government of India there should be no diplomatic relation, good relation with Pakistan. There is no scope, but at least grant 10,000 visas to Hindus to come up Bharat, at least monthly, at least more than 1 lakh visas annually. They have to create a quota for minority of Pakistan. And one more important thing, these days we have aligned with the Sikh leadership, with the Christian leadership of Pakistan. So we are trying to raise our voice, minorities' voice of Pakistani minorities' voice globally. So this is the thing which we are going to do on ground. We did things with a pure heart and we got a lot of results. Now this is the time to take this battle on international platforms, on international forums. So this is again, we are going to do, we need support of a forum like Pragya Bharati also. Wherever you can help us, please do this for these people. Thank you so much. I think I have said enough about these things. Thank you.
Does anybody have a question?
I think we will let him go, but I have two questions to ask and then we can let him go. I think even the fees that these people had to pay for Indian citizenship has been reduced.
Yeah, it is 100 rupees only. Earlier,
correct.
It,
from 10,000 rupees.
No, it was earlier, it was in section 5(1)A, it was 2,000 only. In that particular thing, 10,000 is for normal foreigner. In section 6(1), the thing was for 12 years, now it becomes reduced 11 years.
So it is 100 rupees now.
It is 100 rupees now. It is 100 rupees in 2016. Rajnath Singh ji did this on our request.
Great. And the second one is, I think yesterday I had a talk with Aminder ji also. This act, Citizenship Amendment Act, applies to people who came on or before 31st December 2014 only. People who come after that, this CAA does not apply to them.
Sir. It is not correct. If someone comes in December 2019, right? The 5 years tenure was 2014. So people who came 5 years before and their passports are expired, they are eligible to get citizenship without valid document. But person who came on 1st January 2015, they are also eligible in 5 years, but they have to keep valid visa and valid passport. That's it. So the limit is 5 years for everyone. And the rebate is for people came before 31st December 2014. Documentation rebate only.
If somebody has come in 2000, let's say December 2019, right? 1st of December 2019, Does he have to wait for 5 years to
get it? Are you hearing me?
12 years.
Yeah, Jay, we are hearing you. Hello? Bolo, Jay.
Nee, sir, I didn't got your question. Please repeat, pardon.
So, can you hear me?
Yeah.
So, if a person comes to India on 1st of December 2019, okay, does he have to wait for 5 years or 12 years?
5 years. If they are from minority community of Pakistan, they have to wait for 5 years only.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. Thanks a lot, Jayji, and wish you all the best, and may Mata Hinglaj and Mata Banot help you, and we are all there with you.
Definitely, in some years, I will take you to Hinglaj Mata for darshan as state guest in Azad Balochistan.
Shyamji is trying to say something to Jay. What is Shyamji saying to Jay?
Ji.
One second. Shyamji, before that, we also have Yashwant Maharaj Ji. Yashwant Maharaj Ji is
from Toronto. Sindhi,
no, yeah, correct. He is a Sindhi Pakistani Hindu. He lives in Toronto. He has migrated to Toronto. He's also on our call just now.
Very good, very good.
Yashwant Maharaj Ji.
Shyamji has to say something to Jay, then we will let Jay go.
Okay. Shyamji, one second. Yeah.
Jai Ji, Hariom. Namaskar, Jai Julelal.
Hariom, Jai Julelal.
Requesting you from last 1.5-2 years, I was also trying for two Pakistani Hindu girls. We got their documents. I think I told you when I was in Delhi.
Yeah, you told me, sir.
Guided me also, thank you. And happy to hear that your people are doing so much services. But I requested you earlier just to remind you through this platform, because Pragna Bharati will be very happy that I have made this request to Pragna Bharati, since you told them what help they can do to you. Send to families, I'll absorb them in South India at various Hindi business establishments. I can get them jobs. I told you earlier, if you feel anybody, that embargo is removed. Earlier it was in few states only, they were movement. Now they are allowed to go anywhere, I think.
No, sir. They cannot go outside of state. So why we stopped everything? Because the Citizenship Amendment Act came, and we have 37,000 eligible people in Rajasthan. So we thought it is going to apply soon and they will get citizen in some months. Then we will split them with the document. They are waiting since long time. So that is why it was stopped by us, that we are, now we are all focusing on citizenship only, and they are going to get it soon. And we are send a lot of people to you soon.
Yeah, thank you. And one more question. Since Dr. Umendra Ratnu said that they have at least six children in each family, request them if they can give away one child for the services of Sindhu Mata to bring other Sindhis. I mean, you can create a sort of army to help other Sindhis who are still stuck up there. If they can give one child for few hours to your organization.
They will, sir, but we need money for that. Because no army runs on its feet. Every army runs on its tummy.
We'll definitely take people to various organizations. We'll do that. I will do that also.
These are amazing people, Shyamji. I'm telling you, I don't need to tell you. You know what I'm talking about. But all the friends here, it just melts my heart when I talk to them. Jay, you can... I'm intervening needlessly in between. I think Jay has to go. Then I'll keep talking.
No, I think we are done with Shyamji Bhai Sahab, and Yashwant Maharaj is also there. He want to say something.
Yeah.
Yashwant Ji, you want to say something?
Hello, namaste to all.
Yashwant Ji.
Namaste. Nice to hear Dr. Umendra Mitru, and the first time I am seeing Jay Ahuja speaking. It was really very nice, and to all your efforts, they are worth, I can say, not even $1 billion, but more than that. Okay. There are a lot of things Dr. Umendra Mitru, Umendra Ratnu said.
Call me Omiji. Call me Omiji.
That's my habit, okay, to be more respectful, okay. That's my habit. I cannot say that, okay. And that why Hindus are facing these problems. Dr. Umendra Ratnu already spoke on that one, but I wrote down all the points. Maybe next time I can go in detail about these points. What is the reason behind that? That's add on with whatever Dr. Ratnu said. And other thing that I know that, okay, everything runs on money, but there are some specific family, they are under death threat right now. This COVID-19 and train is not going, and we are trying our best to contact these families, but still I am not able to contact means the affected people, okay? There is one immediate family, I don't think that, okay, that family is going to survive if nothing, we didn't get do anything. And these are the issues currently. And on the other side, that people who are already there, and Nimat Ekam is already helping a lot of people. But one other problem they are facing, the people who are already arrived in India, and what they are facing, especially I'm talking about Jaipur and Jodhpur. The people, mostly the people, they are poor people. And for visa extension, for small things to report to the that police station, they go over there. And they are really face a lot of problems just to bribe them. Because
you should tell Maharaj, them directly contact us.
Maharaj, already 3 police officers got suspended on our complaints. Yes. In Jaipur, I can claim openly on the forum, if a single penny they are asking from anyone, especially from Meghwals, from Sindh and Punjab in Jaipur, so they know they have terror of our names. They are afraid of us. Yeah. They are terrorized. They lost their jobs. Departmental inquiry suspended.
एक भी पाकिस्तानी हिंदू को एक रुपए की भी रिश्वत नहीं देने पड़ी है पिछले 4 साल में हम जब से हैं.
And again, one more thing.
Due to Jai's efforts.
In Jodhpur, the biggest group is working with us, and we have an office in slum area. So we have an office in slum area.
Hear that?
My request, Yashwant ji, is that please, if you find out any single Hindu being harassed in Rajasthan, just send me his details. I will take care of that person personally.
If anybody, I'm in contact with a lot of people, but that means if I see that, okay, if there is a single person, then I'm already telling them, okay, contact your office in Jodhpur, because mostly the people I know, they are from Jodhpur and Gujarat. Okay, so mostly
Send me the details. Send me the details.
We will be operative in Karnavati, Ahmedabad also. Soon we will be operative, and in Jodhpur, Jaipur, we are there. Nobody can ask bribe if our person is standing in front of police or administration people. They don't have courage to ask for a single rupees bribe.
Very good. And that right now, I think it is Nimat Ekam is making big difference. So that is already taken care of. But in case in future, if
Maharaj, one more thing. 16 district collectors of India from 9 states got the power to grant citizenship, but it happened in Jaipur first time.
Yes.
Great.
So we are here. Don't worry, just share our contact details. Me and Dr. Ratnu's number, we will take care of everything. So one Maharaj is working, Chidam Sharma from Mithi with us, full-timer. And one old Rajput kid is working with us, Bharat. And 2 Meghwals are working with us in Jaipur. And in Jodhpur, Bheel and Meghwals are the only frontline army of Nimit Ekam.
Okay, can I request one thing about this, our Zoom conferences?
Please.
See this, we are talking. This is a very serious information, serious discussion. And we are taking the names and all these things. there are departments in Pakistan, they are working on these things to collect all this data, manipulate data, and make the policy what we do against us. So we need to be very careful recording it and posting it on the YouTube or social platform, especially the names and all these things, because there are departments, they are day and night busy in Pakistan to make the policy depending upon what upon is going on the social media and around the world, especially regarding Hindus.
That is why we never, as a matter of principle and policy, we never take name of our Pakistani brothers. We only name people who are out of Pakistan. We know that the moment we name somebody in Pakistan, that person will be eliminated. Yeah. And yes, that is something every listener, everybody who's in this conference should be very mindful of. Do very not good. Expect anything from a Pakistani Hindu in Pakistan, because he's a captive of a very, very violent jihadi force. We are free people. They are not.
Yeah. Don't worry about it. We are ensuring that nothing of that sort happens. There is no mention of any person, any contact from Pakistan. It is only people in India that we are talking about.
And I would like to get your attention to, there was 3 days back, okay, there was one case, that girl, she converted and married to a Muslim physician, and now she was tortured, harassed, and then she was forced to prostitute. So that girl had the press conference 3 days ago. So now they are, I try to get all the information, but I'm not able to reach these people, parents, and especially now the girl is with parents, but the girl converted, so girl is Muslim, parents are Hindu, and if the girl stays at the means parents' house, that's a big problem and big threat, death threat. So this situation is currently going on. I'm trying my best, but I didn't get that family is from Mirpur Khas. So, and I didn't get the contact. I especially told a few friends to at least give me the direct phone number, but
Dada, we will do.
That press conference, I think I posted that video that she is talking in Sindhi or Urdu. So if we can get that information and what is going to be happen, I think that whatever the arrangements they made, after 6 months or 1 year, we will hear the story, the girl committed the suicide. That will be killing, but it will be represented as a suicide.
Well, there is another side to this. I really don't have much sympathy here, because this girl was an adult when she converted. She was a case of love jihad, right?
Yes.
Mehak?
No, Yashwant Maharaj-ji, we'll do one thing. I think we'll take this offline. You have the contacts of Omender-ji and Jay Ahuja-ji.
Yes. So
we'll do it separately.
Cases, yeah, specific cases, we'll deal it separately, not on this call. We should not.
But let me give you good news, Girdhar sir. Yeah. Girdhar sir, let me give you good news vis-a-vis a specific detail. There was this child, Mehak Kumari. She was picked up in January 2020 from her home. Her father, I've shared that video with you. The father is seen crying on television. We made that video viral. We went on the social media. We tagged Indian government officials, Indian ministers. We mocked the entire Pakistani establishment, and we kept the fire up.
At least 40 debates on mainstream media in India. We tried, and it happened.
And with all the blessings of Hinglaj Mata and the great work Jay has done on this front with awakening of the media and all social media, I was taking care of. The girl has been returned to her mother.
Great. Fantastic.
Yeah, I know that personally. I spoke with the person. He gave the shelter for at least 4 to 5 months. She stayed in their house from court. She didn't go with the parents, but she came to third party house, one of our friends. She stayed there, and when I spoke with them, she was still there.
So one girl child has been rescued, and if you read the judgment, the judge has been very forthright and candid in his judgment. Some very good points have come up. So I think if we use this judgment, we can save a lot many Hindu girls now. So that's a good news about a specific case.
What was the main point in that case? The girl in the court that she asked the judge, this is my love marriage. I'm trying to be means have a love marriage with this boy. If this boy is telling me to convert, I'm not going to convert. I will remain Hindu. And if he wants to marry me, then it's fine. It's love marriage. If he wants to me first convert, I won't convert. And she came back. She said, I'm not going to go with him. I will go with the parents.
And this is a 14-year-old child.
Yeah.
In Pakistani law, the minimum age of girl is 18 years for marriage.
Yeah, so we will evaluate and read this judgment, but I was just sharing a good news. Jay, you have to go?
Yes, right. Sure. Like I said, Yashwant Maharaj-ji,
Dhanyawad Girdharji.
Okay, yeah, I think Jay Ahuja-ji has to leave. Thank you, Yashwant Maharaj-ji, and thank you. Ahuja-ji. Thank you so much for sharing all your experiences and, for the great service that you are doing to the Sindhis, our own brothers, we have really messed up with them, and you are doing a yeoman service. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Yeah. Hello.
Yeah, I'm here. So, any more questions?
Yeah. So. Friends, I think you can, use your hand button and you can raise your hand button so that we can start unmuting you for your questions. But before that, Omenderji, so what exactly are the kind of services that you are doing for these people when they come into your fold? Maybe you can walk through micro issues in terms of their education, their challenges that you're facing in their communities, probably how are they getting married? Do they have enough pool, or are they getting married to Indians, or how is it happening? How is their life being monitored, and what's that kind of help that you're doing? Do they get jobs? Do they start their businesses? What's the kind of support that Nimittekam is doing?
It all boils down to funds, Giridhar bhai. There is this whole concept of dharmansh I have been trying to propagate into the Hindu community. It's like a Hindu zakat, Every Hindu on this globe must give a small amount of money, say 100 rupees, 200 rupees, 500 rupees, whatever his economic status and his condition can allow him, on a monthly basis to organizations like Nimittekam or whatever cause is dear to them. I'm not saying that the Pakistani Hindu issues, everything, anybody wants to support the Sangha or other organizations like Agniveer or Indic Collective, they want to go for the legal warfare supporting Hindus. Every Hindu on this globe has to give 100 rupees or 200 rupees every month. That is the level of funds we require to actually give them an economic future in Bharat. Right now, the amount of funds we are getting is approximately 2 lakh rupees every month, which is a huge number in terms of the way we started. We started with our own money, but right now Hindus are giving us that much amount of money. And with that, we are paying salaries to 5 people in Jaipur and 3 people in Jodhpur. So the moment the train from Karachi land comes and these people land in Bharat, approximately 200 to 300 Hindus per week walk to our kiosk in Jodhpur and they get registered with us. Our people take their passports and take it to the FRRO office and get the long-term visa registered immediately. A thing that this government did in its last tenure was to extend the tenure of long-term visa from 1 year to 5 years, which was a huge relief because otherwise every year we would have to renew it. So now the LTV is given for 5 years and these people are more or less free of the police hassles. I remember a time 7 years ago when I used to get calls from police stations. There was a young boy who had a Pakistani passport. He was driving an auto rickshaw for his survival. And at the night he was caught by the local police and the only document he had to show was a Pakistani passport. And the thick-headed police wala, they just took him and arrested him that he's a Pakistani. All night I was there, kept up, and we pleaded with the person, this is a Hindu, he's a refugee, this, that. So all that is a matter of past. Now the police, the government administration, the bureaucracy is very sympathetic to us. And most of the times we don't even come to know of any hassle. Most of the time the bureaucracy is so sympathetic, at least in Rajasthan, that they take care of every issue these Hindus face through our local people in the offices in Nimittekam, Jodhpur and Nimittekam, Jaipur. Once these people have these documents secure, then they are very confident of working. And because most of these people coming are have a huge community base. For example, Meghwals. Meghwals are coming from southern Punjab of Pakistan, Rahim Yar Khan district. Sindhis are coming from rural interior Tharparkar. They are mostly Bhils. There are also a few Bagdis. There are a few Kolis, Balais, and Or Rajputs. They are all scheduled caste communities. Now, these people all have their people in some place, somewhere. Not very rich, but somehow surviving, already entrenched, already integrated with the mainstream Hindu society. So what Nimittekam right now does is to take a Meghwal to a Meghwal, to take a Bhil to a Bhil community, take a Balai to a Balai community. Then there are intermediate OBCs like Malis and in my own community, Charans. We have very few people. We refer Malis to Malis. Malis are rich people. Ashok Gehlot is a Mali. So Malis are pretty well off in this state and they take care. Then there are the upper castes. There are Agarwals. There are mainly Maheshwaris. Even today, there are 4 lakh Maheshwaris in Pakistan. 4 lakh. And Maheshwaris, we refer to Maheshwaris. Very sadly, I have to state that the most petty and the most shallow help comes from the upper caste. They don't help these Hindus. I have no reason. I have no reason why that happens. But since the numbers are very few from upper caste, we honestly don't face. For example, there was this doctor. I went to at least 12 Maheshwaris. At least he's from your community. He has lost everything. He has 3 children. For God's sake, and Maheshwaris are one of the richest communities in India.
Hello. Amandaji.
I'm back. But sadly, Maheshwari ever helped him. And but then as a doctor community helped him. He still works in my hospital. And largely, the caste ecosystem works for our advantage. And the people, and with the CAA now, with 37,000 Hindus and Sardars getting citizenship, we will be able to send them to South India, because a lot of my South Indian friends in Coimbatore, Ashamji and people like you, Monika ji, everybody tells me, please send these Hindus to us. Whereas we can't send them because they are not citizens. They are not courageous people. They are not like the Bangladeshi infiltrators. They will not go without the proper document. But with divine grace now, 37,000 Hindus getting citizenship, we will be pushing them into South Bharat, because they are excellent craftsmen. They are great agriculturalists and they are very hardworking, very honest, and people with highest integrity. So that is the long and short of the kind of economic opportunities we are able to create. But if we get enough dharmansh in coming months, we have started some small skill development projects like agarbatti making, some beauty parlors, some mehendi application courses. These are on a very small scale, a few dozens. But if we can scale it up, we get enough funds, we can put up factories in Jodhpur and Jaipur. But that is something which I think is beyond the scope of Nimittekam as of now. We need government support for that. And we need the Hindu society support for that, to actually give them job opportunities. And to end this up, a lot of rich Hindus call me from Pakistan and they want to come to Bharat. But they say that the kind of life they're living in Pakistan is of affluence and opulence. We do not want to live a life of poverty in Bharat, which is a very legitimate concern. And I tell them, look, you will have to suffer for 5-10 years, But in coming times, as the economy of this country progresses, you can always contribute. So these are rich Hindus, and the number is around 8 to 10 lakhs. They're mostly residents of Karachi and Hyderabad. And some movement of rich Hindus is expected in the next 1 year. But that is something I would not talk about here. But these are the connotations of the economic issues that Nimittekam faces.
Okay. I think there were cases where I think this failed or something like that, right? Some people, especially during the last government in Rajasthan, people were sent back to Pakistan. Some cases which happened and then they converted into Islam.
That was one case, Giridharji. That was one family of Bhils in Jodhpur, and they were notorious. Look, any Pakistani Hindu who comes here has no criminal record. And it is mandated by the Citizenship Act that a Pakistani Hindu refugee will not venture into the border districts, which are Jaisalmer, Barmer, Ganganagar, Bikaner. And this family violated this law by entering into Jaisalmer 3 times. They were warned by the local police, don't do this, don't. Ultimately, they arrested them. When we tried to intervene, the police said, sir, aap bataye, what should we do? And then me and Jay, we backed off that, okay, if these guys are regular offenders, then let them suffer the consequences. But the leftist media played it up to malign the whole issue that, look, Hindus are being deported in BJP rule. That was not the case. These were criminals, not hardcore criminals, but negligent people. And about 8 of them were deported. Yes, they converted to Islam. But you cannot hold this as a gun on the Hindu head that you allow us breaking the law of the land. Otherwise, we will convert. So be it. If you have to come to Bharat, you have to be legal citizens. And as I said, this was an exception. Otherwise, these Hindus are very, very pliable, very soft-hearted, very civilized, very humane people. That was an exception played up by the leftist media. Not a single Hindu was deported who was abiding by the law of the land. I might tell you another story here that there was some goof up by the previous government of BJP when 300 Hindus were to be deported from Jaisalmer for some inadequate documents. That was the time me and Jay, we announced it to the government that if you do that, we're going to block the passage of the road or the train that is going to take these Hindus back, because we knew 300 Hindus deported back to Pakistan meant a huge loss of face for people like us. Hindus there would say, if you can't even protect us, then why are you calling us to Bharat? So we threatened, we took it to Z News, and thankfully Z News covered it without interruption for 10, 11 days. And the government was forced to take it back, and we won that case. That was the only time when we were harassed by the BJP government itself. Otherwise, not a single case. All the stories that you hear about Pakistani Hindus being deported are lies being perpetrated by the leftist media.
Okay, sure. I think let's open it up now for people to ask questions. Abhinandan Reddy ji, please go ahead, sir.
Sir, my question is, could the government not come with a quid pro quo? That is 10,000 Muslims who like to go from here every month to Pakistan. Could that work, or where the Muslims aren't ready from here, or something like that couldn't be done by this government?
Sir, if the borders were opened today, all Muslims of Pakistan will walk into Bharat.
Okay. So we actually have
Muslims of Pakistan living as refugees in Jodhpur, at least 300
Muslims.
Can you beat that? 300 Pakistani Muslims living in Jodhpur,
and they want citizenship here.
Absolutely. We tell them convert to Hinduism, otherwise we will not work for you. That's simple as that. Absolutely. Become Hindus, we'll get your citizenship. You can't have the cake and eat it too. You cannot have Pakistan and then you come back to India and want the comfort and the economic progress and the safety of Hindu society, but you convert to the Islamic society. No, it doesn't work like that. Not for, I am a very straightforward person, sir. The other day also I was talking to Zafarji and I said, just told him one thing. You want us to support you, you become a Hindu.
That's I heard it. You, sir. Yes.
That's it.
Yeah, Abhinandanji, see, I worked in the Gulf as well. Trust me, many of the Pakistani Muslims who work in the Gulf, they are desperate for India to open up the gates.
I know.
So much so that, I'll tell you a typical example. When we had this issue of PIO card, you know, person of Indian origin or overseas Indian citizen, OIC card.
Oh yeah. That's interesting.
Yeah. So I think Modi ji announced that both these cards are going to be clubbed or something like that. When this announcement was made, the discussion in Pakistani channels, what I saw, be it GOTV or, you know, all these guys, the discussion was, are we not persons of Indian origin? So our fathers, grandfathers were also in India, right? So why Pakistan and Bangladesh have been exempted? So India is a racist country. Of course, they'll keep abusing you, but heart of hearts, they're desperate to be called Indians. This is something which I observed there. You know, externally they keep blabbering, they keep talking nonsense against India, but you dig a little deeper, they're desperate to be called Indians. So this is what I see, open up the floodgate and they're all going to be here.
It's a schizophrenia, Girdarji. It's a split personality.
But then I had suggested, if you remember, on the last call with Zafarji also, I think we need to play a psychological game. You give Indian citizenship to some prominent people, you know, I don't know, cricketers, their movie artists, some Muslims, you give it. The intelligentsia of Pakistan, you start giving it, you know, fast-tracking their citizenship in India. You will see exodus. Pakistan will just be drained. Automatically, Pakistan will collapse. You don't have to give to a lot of people. You just give to like 400-500 guys and then that's it. Pakistan is over. Psychological game also we need
doable.
To play.
I think it's doable. It's a good idea.
I mean, the whole Pakistan cricket team will come to India. You know, they'll immediately migrate. They need to play in IPL. They'll just vanish. What are you talking about? You know, we need to play this games.
Psychological games. It's not a bad idea.
Yeah, sure. Next is Balaji. Balaji Chivukula. Balaji ji, please go ahead.
Umanjar ji, thank you, Giridhar Garu. Umanjar ji, shat shat pranam aapko aur Ahuja ji ko. I have nothing else to add, no questions to ask. Tell me how, I mean, I'm a foot soldier for Pragna Bharati here, but I'd like to extend my time and whatever efforts which I can put in for Nimittekam also. I'm ready from Hyderabad. And kindly provide me certain other details of your work in Jaipur, because I worked in, while being based out of Bhopal, I took care of entire Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh and all regions. So I have my team there still who are still in touch with me. I can raise whatever possible funds and to support Nimittekam and for whatever work you need. And I promise
I'll tell you. Thank you so much for your kind words. I'll tell you, there are two things an average Hindu can do. Not only a worker of a Pragya Bharati or a BJP or RSS guy, average Hindu has to do this. We have to sell our story to the global world. And to that extent, please understand, a compassionate law like Citizenship Amendment Act gets a bad name because we did not have the enough resources to purchase op-eds in Washington Times and New York Times.
I understand.
Did you read the post? And even today, Tahir Gora of Tag TV was conducted an interview with me and he said, Doc Saab, the entire air in the Western world is against this government, that this is a discriminatory law. And our Hindu and our Sikh brothers were the pioneers in opposing this law. So that shows a distinct amount of indifference and ignorance on this critical genocide happening right next to our door. It baffles my mind that we are losing 3 girls every day. Close to 1 crore Hindus have been digested by jihadis in Pakistan alone. We used to be 23%. Now we are 2%. In Bangladesh, we used to be 35%. We are 7%. Instead of being the victims, we are the perpetrators. It means we have not been able to articulate our view properly to our own people, number one. So help us with the narrative. Reach to every Hindu that you can. Because Hindus are smart people. If you tell them, you'll be able to touch that nerve which will stimulate the compassion in them. And secondly, it is about dharmanchya. Right now, I'll give you an idea of the kind of money that we need. Out of the 70 lakh Hindus in Pakistan, 60 lakh do not even have the money to get a passport. Forget okay. that they will travel to Islamabad from Karachi, which is 1,000 kilometers long journey. They will wait out in front of the Indian embassy, and 4 or 5 such trips, they will be exploited by the touts, and then they will get an Indian visa, and then they will migrate. So the cost of taking one Hindu out of Pakistan comes out to be 5,000 Indian rupees.
Right from the stage of applying for a renunciation certificate, moving into India, and yes. Re-establishment charges are separate, correct?
See, re-establishment is not our concern. We will take him out and put him on Indian land.
Achha, theek hai.
That is 5,000 rupees. Now, I have 2,000 Hindus who have penniless. Somebody's were penniless. So, if I have to take them out, I need 1 crore rupees.
I understand.
That is the kind of funding we are looking at. We need in the next 2-3 years. Because let me tell you, these 70 lakh Hindus either will be taken out or will be converted in the next 10 years. That is the upper limit. That is the upper limit. The kind of economic downspin that Pakistan is in, the brunt will be borne by these Hindus and Christians and Sardars.
Yes.
They
yes.
will be converted or killed or sold or whatever. So we have a short window of 4 years. We are desperate for funds. Once the border opens, I'm going to go to the world begging for money. I'm going to go to Hindus begging for money. That just like Israel was populated when people sold their golden teeth to purchase a Jew and settle them in Israel, we will have to purchase Hindus from Pakistan. That is the reality of the matter.
Do you have any Sardar? I got your point. So do you have any Sardar also who have sought refugee to come into India?
Oh, yes. 300 Sardars right now. We have their files with us. They are in Faridabad, Delhi. They came in 2008 and they are living lives of extreme suffering and extreme poverty.
And, Trust me, sir. While you were narrating such incidences and visa process and Jay Saab, jo bata rahe the, the other visa processes and settlements and all the work cost, I was thinking about, if this video after the recording, once Pragna Bharati releases this video from YouTube, I can take this excerpt and share it to certain other friends from the different parts of the globe. One from the Sardar community, few of them from the Sardar community. Who are those people who can be touched? Jiske dil ko chhute hain, tab wahan se paisa main nikalunga.
Nankana sahab ke granthi, Nankana sahab ke granthi ki beti uth chuki hai.
I know.
Aur aaj tak nahi lautai gayi hai. In spite of assurance from the governor of the Pakistani Punjab.
Absolutely.
What kind of a world are we living in, sir? Is this the way a civilized world conducts itself? The constitutional authority of a state has given assurance that Jagjit Kaur will be returned. I have that video. I can share it with all of you. Government of India should take that video to every bloody embassy and show this. That this is what they are doing to a child. Instead, when the brother and the father, Mohan Singh, and they wanted to get the child back, they attacked Nankana Sahib. And they said, you're going to rename it Ghulam-e-Mustafa Nagar. What Khalistani narrative?
I have a Gulati family in Jaipur itself, sir, who are from Karachi, Lahore, who are settling in Jaipur right now. She's part of my team and still reports to me. Sir, I can motivate these people to contribute and help Nimit Tekam to go to a higher level. That's my promise.
Yes, that's the whole. Thank you so much. I'd like Girdarji to kindly connect me with you once this talk is over. Thank you so much.
I think yesterday you put up your mobile number in the other Zoom call with Zafar Say.
I'll put it again.
I've noted it down.
Not just Balaji alone, but our request is everybody who has come on our call should please visit nimittekam.org and you should be a part of this movement to save our people across the border. So everybody kindly do your bit to the extent that you can. That's our fervent appeal to all of you. Yeah, thanks Balaji.
Thank you, sir. Omenderji.
Thank you. Vinod ji, please go ahead, sir. Vinod ji, please go ahead.
Hello, namaskar, namo namaha. I'm Vinod Sharma. Recently heard a speech of or a conversation with Tahir Gora or Menderji, and then since then I'm connected with him and listening him. I'm from Canada, Alberta, and I have a couple of suggestion. Probably you guys already may be working on that. So I can see that the Nimiketam is struggling with the fund issue. So I have a small suggestion. Can we approach temples where everybody donates a lot of money and even government has got eye on that money? Can we ask them to give some of the fund, divert to this cause? And not only that, there are like Baba Ramdev's business. I'm sure they can give some money. Apart from that, we will definitely will contribute and try to convince people. But I think the temples are the excellent source where people donate like anything, and even government and or anybody else is taking that money out. Why do we allow that money to go to the government, not to these organizations which are working, day and night? So one thing is that. The other one is can we work with the our Hindu organizations to create a simple rule to convert Muslim or bring them back to the Hindu clan? Simple one, not to tag them Malaj or they are polluted or something like a simple kalma has been read and then he converts into the Islam. That's it. And after, as you said, that people, we are telling them to convert to Hindu and then we will offer you the citizenship. I'm sure once they are here, the Muslim in India, they are so cunning, they will approach them and they will try to bring them back. So we have to have a very simple rules and make the community to accept them so that they can be fully observed. Otherwise, people will not, because I have listened to Faiz Khan, the one who is, I think, RSS Pracharak, and somebody asked him, why don't you convert? He says, if I convert, no Hindu is accepting me. My children will suffer. They cannot get married.
To answer your first question, temple money is a very complicated issue in Bharat these days. Subramanian Swamiji won a case against the Chidambaram temple, and I don't know what happened of that money and what happened of that victory. Did Hindus get control of Chidambaram temple? I'm not really sure. I've been in touch with Ramesh ji, who is fighting the temple freedom movement, and he's quite frustrated with the kind of progress he is making. I don't know the reasons why this government is not freeing the temples and bringing it under Hindu control. They say that they are not doing it because they don't trust the Hindu trusts who will then control this money, which is a legitimate concern. But our counter question is, are you telling us that Muslim trusts or Christian trusts are more honest than Hindu trusts? So if there is fudging and corruption in Hindu, in Muslim and Christian trusts, there will be some corruption in the Hindu trusts. But as of now, this is not in my domain of expertise that I can comment on that. I have personally approached about 24 dharmacharyas and ashrams and mathadishas and kathavachaks to talk about Pakistani Hindus. And my couple of posts in the Facebook and the social media in the past 3 days have evoked very strong responses from Hindus, because I abuse these kathavachaks and sadhaks and these mathadishas. Not one of them offered us the platform to talk about Pakistani Hindu genocide. I do not know the reason. But if anybody can connect me to such a sadhu, such a temple, I'm more than glad to touch their feet and offer my humble pranams to them, that please save these Pakistani Hindus. Please give them a platform from which they can voice their angst, their suffering, and their abject humiliation that they have undergone, so that the Hindu community is able to, you know, help them. That's part number one. The second question that you asked, again, it's beyond my paycheck to devise a new. I think Vishwendu Parishad is doing a good job of Ghar Vapsi. We have organizations like Agniveer, which are doing very good job of Ghar Vapsi, and they have pretty much simplified the whole thing. However, in a non-institutionalized religion like Hinduism, to get a single line and will be a little arduous. But then this is for Dharmacharyas, for the Hindu Parishad and the RSS to do. It's a great idea. But I think anybody who wants to become a Hindu doesn't have to chant a mantra. He becomes a Hindu by just absorbing the idea of Hinduism. But I get your point, what you're saying, but this is again not my area of, not my domain to intervene. This is for the Dharmacharyas, and Dharmacharyas are drugged. They are drugged into property grabbing, and the lesser said the better. I don't want to touch sensibilities here. So we'll see where this goes. But your points, both your points are valid. Thank you so much, Vinodji.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, Vinodji, if I may just add to what Omenderji said, we have two types of temple administrations, one under the government and another the private. Government, it is secular government, they will never pay money for Hindu causes. You can only preach, they'll only make the payment, I mean, they'll release the payments for preachers who are going to talk about Bhagavad Gita, you know, Rama and Bharat, that's it. For a Hindu cause, for stopping conversions or bringing these people, they will not pay. Now let's come to the second one. Like Omenderji said, second one again, it's a money mafia, land mafia. So as you know, the Dharmakartas will not leave that money at all for the causes that we are talking about. So both ways we are damned. The government, you are damned. Private, we are damned. On both sides, the Hindu endowment is being wasted. It has been, in fact, all the Shankara Pitas have been established by Adi Shankara only to protect Hindu Dharma. In fact, the Dakshinamnaya Pitha, that is the South India Pithadipati, Sringeri, Sringeri Pithadipati in the 13th century, Swami Vidyaranya Tirtha, he created an empire, Vijayanagar Empire, to fight the Muslims.
Yes,
he himself was the prime minister of that particular country, for that kingdom. So, this is what Adi Shankara had ordained all the Shankara Pithas. Now, I think it's inappropriate for us to comment on what is happening with any of these Pithas.
Except Swami Jayendra Saraswati Swamigal, Paramatma unko shanti de wo jahan bhi hain, except that great sadhu and Swami Jayadayanand Saraswati of Coimbatore, not one sadhu has even talked about Pakistani Hindus.
Omenderji, you are talking about Pakistani Hindus. I am waiting to listen if they have spoken about Kashmiri Pandits. in our own borders. I have not seen one of them visit. I have not seen one of them visit one temple in Kashmir.
They have stabbed us in the eye. They have stabbed us Hindus in the eye.
So anyway,
and that's why I have bypassed them, and I request to directly to Hindus to give Dharmansh. That's the only way for us to survive.
We have reverence to the pithas of all these people, but then you've been a little more blunt, but we can only pray to them that they need to really rise up and then answer their conscience and then see what is happening to the Hindu samaj, and they need to do something, and something very fast. That's all demand of.
Shri Krishna destroyed entire humanity for one Draupadi's humiliation. Three Hindu girls are being picked every day, Giridhar Bhai. How can we eat? Yeah. How can we sleep?
I agree with you, sir. I agree with you. And I'm sharing your pain. All I'm saying is, all these pithas are created for the protection of Hindu Dharma. And we can only pray and wish. And, we can tell them that this is what is their duty. Beyond that, we are not going to wait for them. We do what we have to do. That's all I'm saying.
Yes.
Perfect. Yeah.
Kannan, we have Shri Krishna with us.
Yeah. Kannanji, please go ahead. Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Vijay. Thanks a lot, Homendra ji. Very, very nice to see your views. And I didn't know about before in detail, although I'm based in the UK. I'm from Tamil Nadu originally. About the specific issue you're talking about today, about this
really?
Much level of violence about on the Hindu minority in Pakistan. I never know that much. Unbelievable, really. I mean, obviously, you can extend hands in many levels here. I look at the mathematics. You're talking about 2 crores, including both Pakistan and Bangladesh, about 2 crores. That means around 5,000 rupees per people. You need at least 10,000 crores, right? In one level?
Yep.
You don't really help everybody to come here.
Yeah, see, the Bangladeshi Hindus is a different issue. Bangladeshi Hindus are actually a lot of, they are very empowered. They are in government jobs. They are educated. They have connections overseas. I'm talking about 6 million Hindus who can't read, who can't write, who cannot find their way out of the slavery that they are in. So let us cut this down to 6 million. We don't need to reach out to 2 crore. It's a 6 million Hindus that we will have to purchase.
Wait, how feasible is that? I'm just asking because, I'm sure you're already working with the government and many levels. I've speak to Giriji offline. If it's feasible, then why not? Other means can be arranged. I think we can discuss in detail. That's one part of bringing them to India. Then once they're landed, there's other big issue of their own survival and their own development. So for example, in our area, we can give lots of opportunities in the farming level. And also craftsmen, you said lots of craftsmen. It's a very good thing to have. We need lots of craftsmen in India, in Bharat, We need lots of craftsmen to do a huge level of next level growth, progressive growth in the world. I think we can talk about second part, which is the after landing, how can we help them in a different form with a dignified life and dignified job, just not just giving them food and shelter. Beyond that, for their own families, obviously their kids and going to university and beyond that, that's okay. I'm just thinking about the two aspects. I think, this is not a forum to discuss in detail, I understand. First of all, thank you so much for your highlighting the specific issues there. We will speak to Guruji and you offline.
It's good that you brought this up. If 6 million Hindus have to be purchased and that kind of money has to be raised, I'm sure that can be raised. Because when I started working on this issue about 10 years ago, I was just like any other middle-class doctor. Even today, I'm just a middle-class doctor running my nursing home, taking care of my old mother and taking care of my family. So when I look back, we saved 10,000 Hindus. I said, did we save 10,000 Hindus out of Pakistan? So to say that whether we will be able to purchase the 6 million Hindus, once we do that inner sankalpa, we make a promise to ourselves that we will do this. I think the universe conspires to help you in that. The only missing link is the Hindu society's sankalpa, once we take that sankalpa to take these Hindus out of that hellhole, we'll do that. And the rehabilitation in Bharat should not be a problem. We have enough. The economy is on the rise. We can create enough opportunities for them. These are very honorable people and very crafty people. The kind of clothes they design, kind of agricultural input they do. Right now we are into agarbatti making and very hardworking, very decent folks. Walking gods, you come and meet them and you just melt. The kind of innocence they have in the heart. I was asking a Meghwal once, why didn't you convert if you were facing so many hardships? Why didn't you read the Kalma? And you know what he said? You know what he said? He said, Sahab, baap dadaon ka dharm aise kaise chhod de?
Sahi baat hai, yeah. I think that's the heart, right? I can imagine that, yes. Yeah.
How can we give up on our ancestral dharma? Can you expect that answer from any of these convent educated brain dead bozos? this is
no,
the purity,
really, no.
And the beauty of an innocent Hindu who says, I will be loyal to my dharma, whatever be the cost. And that is why these Hindus deserve to be saved. Because they're fighting.
Absolutely. Yeah, one final thing on. Do we have any families that can come to Tamil Nadu? I mean, I can take maybe 100 families right now.
The CAA becomes effective, we have 37,000 people who will be needing to be relocated. Then it, because right now they are all restricted to Rajasthan. They cannot go out of the Rajasthan because visa restrictions. Once they become citizens, then I already have plans for shifting them to Coimbatore. I have a friend, Ramya. She is a great friend and a great Sanatani. So she has huge farmhouses and all that. So I'll get in touch with you when I need some employment.
We are in Trichy also and many places in Karnataka and planning around India. Yeah, we'll talk about offline. Yeah. I mean, not take on this today's call. Definitely very good to see you and meet you. Yes. Thanks, Gridhaji, for your association and thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm holding my phone in.
Yeah, thank you.
I'm shifting my place because my battery is running low, so I'll have to. I'm just shifting my place. That's all. I'm still with you guys.
Okay. So the thing is, there's a third way, Ominderji. One, you said either they come here or second is they convert, right? There's a third way that we as a nation do something to Pakistan and. We liberate Sindh. We break it up into
aapke muh mein ghee shakkar.
And then Baluchistan and Sindh, Sindh probably will join India and Baluchistan will probably stay independent. And Khyber Pakhtunkhwa will probably be part of greater Pashtunistan of Afghanistan. And that's it. And we need to just deal with the Hindus in Punjab and that's it. We don't need to worry about the rest of them.
I have a thought on this, if I may say. The rich Hindus of Pakistan are barely 0.1%. I mean, 10 lakh Hindus who are rich.
Yeah.
Do you know the amount of tax that they submit to that state? 17%.
Correct.
17% is the amount of tax they are giving to Pakistan. You take these 10 lakh Hindus out of that equation, this state is going to collapse.
Yeah.
That is what we need to focus on. That's what we are right now consulting with the government of India. That suppose these rich Hindus who are traders in rice, dal, in cotton, jihadis are all brain dead, right? They can only rape and they can only kill. The trade, the economy of that country is still being run by Hindus. Can you believe that? Suppose we take these a million Hindus out of that equation. The process of implosion of that state will be that much faster.
Yeah.
And we have to start attacking the theology. I have no qualms that a state which breeds people who run madrasas as an industry to pick up Hindu and Sardar girls, rape them for months
treat them like vegetable. There is something basically wrong with the philosophy that is breeding such human beings. I mean, for all my hatred for jihadis, I cannot imagine damaging or hurting a child. That is where I draw a line. Any religion, a child is sacred. A child is a child of God. So we got to attack the basic theology which creates such monsters.
Yeah, sure. Sure, sir. Nagesh ji?
Yes, yes. Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Yes. This is related to the geographic spread of Hindus in Pakistan. Basically, they are concentrated in Sindh province. Everyone knows that one. And here and scattered here and there in Balochistan also. Now, my question is, Major, how many are from Balochistan? You have processed the visas. And when we speak to Baloch people, they say that Hindus there are very well protected. And we Baloch themselves protect them. And there are many doctors over there and all these people. And on and off, we hear some cases too, here and there, that Hindu businessmen were killed here and there. And so what is their status there, Hindus in Balochistan?
Frankly speaking, Nimittekam has not been in touch with Balochi Hindus. We are mainly dealing with Sindhi Hindus and Punjabi Hindus. Punjabi Hindus are localized to a small area of Rahim Yar Khan, southern Punjab, from where Meghwals are coming to us. They are the bulk of people coming to us, at least in Jaipur. In Jodhpur, the bulk of people who are coming are Bhils from Tharparkar, Mithi, Narkana, Jacobabad, and this area. From the borders of Balochistan and Sindh, there is a huge number of Hindu population living there. We have a few Hindus right now registered with Nimittekam. But if you're talking about Quetta and proper Balochistan, mostly the Baloch people go to Delhi and to the North India. They do not migrate through Sindh. So Nimittekam doesn't have a direct experience with Baloch Hindus. But I believe 20,000 odd Hindus still live in Balochistan. They are all rich traders, doctors and all that. That's right. But they're all cosmetic. You know, if you hear a story of a Baloch, I have written an article on CAA, the children of Goebbels. I quoted Goebbels that when you tell a lie 100 times, it becomes the truth. So that is what happened with CAA, that these thugs parroted the lie of victimhood. In that, I start that article with a Baloch Hindu. His story is really heart-shattering. I'm just quoting it to give you an idea of what these Hindus are facing in Balochistan. This guy came to Bharat in 2006. His only daughter was picked up from his home. He was being raped by these Derawala, Bhuktis and all these people. He went there with the Hindu community. He could hear the shrieks of this child. Imagine the trauma a father was undergoing. And he said, okay, you rape her. Now please give her back to me. They said, no, we're not giving her back to you. And the child shouted from inside, Papa, they will not return me. Now you take all my siblings and escape to Bharat. Within a month, this man, I don't want to name him because of security reasons. Let's call him Ganpat Baloch. Okay. And Ganpat came to Delhi. I met him personally 3 times. He has these vacant eyes, you know, because he's, you know what his curse is? His curse is that he knows his daughter is alive. She's breeding jihadis and he can do nothing about it. He got his 3 sons, his wife, and he came to Bharat. Now he lives in Rishikesh. So that is my only interaction with a Balochi Hindu. Balochi Hindus have already been exterminated by the time we got active. these 7 million Hindus who are in Pakistan, most of them are in Sindh, and about 5 to 6 lakh are still in the southern district of Rahimiya.
Thank you.
Yeah, but there is a significant population of Baluchi Hindus
in Makran region.
In the Makran region and these places, they are there. In fact, in Kalat and
Kalat, yes, Kota,
there are a few. You see the annual Hinglaj pilgrimage.
I'm saying that Nimittikam, they have never approached Nimittikam for help, and we have not interacted with them. Hence, I am ill-qualified to comment on that.
Okay. Got it. Thank you.
But there are also a few Hindus even in KPK also.
That way,
Hindus are in Afghanistan also.
Yeah, but Afghanistan, I think hardly 500 families or something like that. They're more or less exterminated over.
Yeah.
I think even Peshawar has, something like 100, 200 families still. But I don't know. I mean, the number can
a matter of time before they are digested.
Yeah, true. But anyway, that's the sad reality of this monster. I think, what can we do? We need to just break it up. That's the only alternative. Yeah. Thanks, Nageshji. Yeah.
Thank you.
Then I think we'll close it here. I think Balaji has something else. Do you want to ask Balaji? Maybe one more last time. Yeah.
Yes, sir. One last question. Umendraji was talking about 37,000 already in India who are waiting for that CAA to be effective, etc. Now, in order to place them in certain other parts of the country, rather than Rajasthan, in other southern parts of the country, can we start jotting down their abilities and capabilities or suitabilities to certain other ways and means how they can, make a living out of. So can we start doing that kind of homework so that we in this group or while we speak to the others also, we can identify certain suitable segments or areas where they can be placed immediately after the CAA is effective?
It's a great idea. That is Jay's expertise. I will consult with him and get back to you. This is very doable.
Sure.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thanks. That's it.
Thank you. Thank you, Balaji. Thank you. I think we'll close the Q&A session. It's already almost 9:30 now. We will share your number and the booklet that you have given. I think we will share it across all the groups as well. The PDF file that you have given.
Anybody wants it, they can ask me. I will mail it to them also. You should read this book.
So that he has sent a PDF that I will post it on all the groups as well. And all of you can pick it up and then take it from there. This is a very sad reality that somebody who survived 1400 years of invasion, conversions, they are unable to survive 70 years of this monster. And not just 70 years, probably they even survived 70 years. But now the situation has come where the survival has become almost impossible. And
they are dying of hunger.
Yeah. I think even in COVID, there were reports that they were not given to, food ration was not given to Hindus. There are videos which
1,000 families have been converted.
Yeah.
In lieu of food.
Yeah, and
I just want to add one thing, Girdharji, to just just to sum it, because in this chain of thought will be lost. Our next project is to take two Pakistani Hindus, two Pakistani Sardars, and two Pakistani Christians on a global trip to all capitals of countries who matter and let them speak their story with their own mouth. Let the world see the victims of this genocide for themselves. That is our only way to defeat the propaganda of Islamists and stupid Hindus and stupid Khalistanis, to take these Sardars, to take these Hindus to the global community. As soon as the air travel resumes, That is my next plan. So I just wanted to brief you on that.
Fantastic, fantastic. I think that will be a great, like what you said, if not goables, but at least true goables. You're actually trying to project what is reality.
And because I need to do it in Bhagyanagar also. I need every city's platform also. Where let Hindus listen to the stories.
Yeah, sure. You know, Pragya Bharati has done 24 programs on CAA within our state in Telangana. We had several speakers going and talking in almost every nook and corner of the states. Every town, almost every district. We have 33 districts. Almost every district we have covered. Literally somewhere or other, and we have sent speakers. There are lots of those speakers are here on the call today. I was one of the speakers. We went to all the corners and spoke about CAA, and some of us participated in the local vernacular TV debates. We did our whatever bit, but like what you said, the Goebbels monster was too massive in front of us. Yet we fought. We held our ground and did our best.
I think if we appeal to the Hindu heart, if we appeal to the Hindu heart directly, then these Hindus, these Sardars, and these Christians will speak their own suffering with their own mouth. And to that extent, Mathadishas and Ashram chiefs have such a huge role. I mean, they have these lakhs of gathering in their ashrams. Can they not give mic to these people for 2 minutes? So that they can voice their agony that this is what we face in Pakistan and there are 7 million more to be rescued. That's my submission to this gathering.
I think Venkatramana ji has raised a hand. I think he'll be the last one to ask a question. Venkatramana ji, you can go ahead. But before that, Omendra ji, do you also have any cases of Buddhists coming to India? Did you deal with any Buddhists, Pakistani Buddhists?
No, not me. Nobody came to Nimittekam.
Okay, fine. Fair enough. Venkatramana ji, please go ahead and ask.
See, namaste ji.
Namaste.
Namaskar ji.
Namaskar.
Great work you are doing for the Hindus of Pakistan. And you were talking about conversions to Islam. Maybe at that point, due to some stress, pressure, they might have converted to Islam temporarily. They may come back to our faith once they are free. Is that not true?
Yes, that is true. But we need to take them out of that ecosystem.
Yeah.
We need to bring them into the Hindu ecosystem.
Yeah.
And right now that itself is a Jurgentanian task for us.
Even if their forefathers have converted to Islam, they might know that their family, within the family, they might be knowing that they were forcibly converted.
Sir, so nobody comes to a weak house. People want strength.
Yeah.
Between a weak horse and a strong horse, whom will you choose?
A naturally strong horse.
So right now, Hinduism is not the strong horse.
Yeah.
We need to have a bright, committed, unrelenting, sharp leadership backed by Hindu funding. Yeah. Then we become the strong horse.
Yeah.
And that is going to happen in the next 5 years. And that is the time we will see the Gharwal.
Ji.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Venkatramana ji. I think that was very informative and very, what do you say? I don't know what to say. You can't even say it's useful. It's like a desperate situation that is there. Pragya Bharati just gave a platform to Amender ji and then we just tried to showcase it. But I think this is something which should touch every heart of every Indian. And, this is a crime that we have done to our brothers and sisters across the border.
Yes.
And
yes.
It's time for us to rectify this crime. And,
yes.
The crime done by our forefathers, we have a duty to redeem it. And I think let's hope and pray that we get the divine blessings to handle this. I will now hand it over to my colleague Chandrasekhar. Go ahead, sir.
Thank you, Giraji. Pavendra ji and Ahuja ji, namaskar and thank you so much. Not enough words to acknowledge your work, sir. You have assigned yourself a big humanitarian work, which actually collected, most of us could even
Hindu
think of.
It's Samuhik Hindu.
Correct. But you see, most of us couldn't even think of such a thing. But you have already, I'm sure, almost halfway, I feel. I would say you are definitely godsend for our Hindu brothers and sisters across the border. After watching the song you have played for us, I'm sure there's not a single person who didn't get emotional. It was very touchy. Actually, you sang it, right?
Yep.
Yeah, great singer in you as well. In fact, it's very tragic, sir, in the sense that there are feelings of low profile, low esteem, and thought that they don't belong there, even after so many years. It's pathetic and tragic. We can understand now. I mean, after your presentation, we could actually feel their pain. Persecution of Hindus, it happens on daily basis, almost on a daily basis, and the temples are burnt and demolished. But no media covers, like you already mentioned. Yet there was one mosque which was demolished here, and then it actually became a big thing and national shame. That is the state of media. You have actually covered all those things. And in any case, with this presentation, sir, you have actually assigned us a task for each and every one of us, every Hindu. We'll be there and we'll be taking our part and we'll take this movement ahead. Thank you so much for your presentation. It was really an eye-opener, I would say. And we got so much of info and actually plan of action for everyone.
Yes.
Thanks so much.
Thank you, Chandra ji. Thank you so much. Thank you, Girdhar bhai. Thank you to everybody who's listened. Focus on awareness and focus on Dharmansh. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Namaste. Bharat Mata Ki Jai.
Bharat Mata Ki Jai.
Mata Ki Jai.